First talk is focusing on heavy ion collisions. So I will start with the very basic picture, repeating some of the things that, for instance, Roberta was saying. Well, it's an old predicted of signature of the quark gluon plasma that the quarkonia should melt one after another, depending on their binding energy in the plasma. You have some examples of melting temperature on the right. With the notable point here is that the 1s, the epsilon 1s, is supposed to be the tightest bound of all. So in an ideal world, this could act as grades in a thermometer and with one grade per measured quarkonium, let's say. And at this moment at the LHC, in AA collisions, we have measured 5, JPSI and Psi2S that Roberta covered. And I will give some words about the 1S, 2S, 3S that was already covered in other talks to some extent. So I like a lot this little summary plot in which we see a super precise plateau of the JPSI, inclusive JPSI down to 0 PT from Alice, which would be like a dream figure in the whole time of the SPS. And we will see towards the end of the talk that the interpretation that we give of that and that Roberta gave of that has nothing to do with sequential melting. It's more like regeneration. And you see also the 1s and the 2s, which also kind of plateaued at large centrality, and this may be used as a thermometer. So just to remind some comparisons between Botomonia and Charmonia. So Botomonia, they have one major drawback, which is now a bit behind us, is that it's 200 times less produced than the JPSI, including the branching fraction to dimuons. So now it's definitely at hand at the LHC, well, excluding the 3S, as we will see, but we have them. It has a few advantages in the thermometer context. First, they are heavier, so I think theorists prefer heavier stuffs. It's also much less regenerated, and that's one of the key issues here. I mean, we have more than 100 charm pairs in a central lead-lead collision at old energy of 2 TeV. Typically, we have 20 times less beauty, and it was even 200 times less beauty at the RIC. That's essentially why beauty was not seen at the RIC. As I said, the epsilon 1s is the most plasma proof, let's say. It's the lowest grade of the thermometer with the highest temperature. There is no feed down from open flavor. There is only feed down from heavier Botomonia, which is an issue in particular of the KB that we will review in the second talk. And the other nice advantages is that they come in proportion that you see on the right, which is essentially the first PP companion run plot that we got in CMS in proportion of 7, 2, and 1 for the 1S, 2S, 3S, which is much, much nicer than the Psi prime, which is 50 times less than the Psi. So if you think about the thermometer picture only, then definitely the Epsilon is the best laboratory to look at. Okay, so that's it for the kind of introduction. These are the data in CMS from the first to the last paper. I will definitely always remember when I saw for the first time the plot on the left, which immediately tells you that you can start playing a bit and saying stuff about the sequential melting. And now the modern version, that was at 2.76 TeV, and the modern version of this is now at 5 TeV, the plot on the right. And you see that the data is super precise and allows to be quite differential. I will not mention it further in the talk, but there is no observed difference between the two square root of S. So everything that I show from now is the 5 TeV, which is the highest that data set that we have. Okay, so that's, I guess, the main plot. It's the RA versus centrality with on the subpanel on the right, the inclusive centrality integrated RA. And you see that it drops with centrality, that the 1S is above the 2S, which itself seems to be above the 3S, which is for now unobserved. And we only set an upper limit on its production. So this pretty much looks like the ordered sequential suppression picture we was dreaming of. So if you stop here, you can go back home and think that we have a thermometer, but of course we will elaborate a bit more on this picture. So plenty of models were compared to this data. So we have like three incarnations of this. The full references are in the backup slides if you want them. But to make a long story short, so on the right, it's co-mover interaction, whatever the co-movers are. I mean, it's not necessarily hadrons. plus the NCTEC parameterization, and you see that it grasps essentially the data for the 1S and the 2S and even the 3S, the unobserved 3S. In the medium, it's more like transport descriptions from RAP and company. Ralph, I think you're still here, right? And another incarnation of that, and it also grasps the essential picture of the suppression. And on the right, it's more a hydrodynamical framework approach by Michael Strickland, and it also grasps the suppression, and it starts to really relate the epsilon suppression to a temperature of the expanding medium. So it gets closer as we can get to the thermometer picture, let's say. That's the double ratio, epsilon 2s over the 1s in lead over in PP. So that was indeed the first experimental observable that we used in CMS, just because it was easy to compute. I mean, plenty of stuff cancel in the ratio, the large part of the efficiencies, the triggers, the luminosity, everything. So it was an easy way to produce a first and fast result with already quite some physics in there. It's also theoretically interesting because some effects will cancel in the double ratio. Like for instance, the NPDFs, they should be very close between a 1S and a 2S, which are not that far apart in mass. So it's interesting. And so you see here a comparison of the, well, the, both the CMS and ALICE data to several models and showing the potential of this observable to maybe a discriminator for models. So for instance, if you look at the comover approach, it's a bit on the lower side with respect to the data, and you can that's the green green curve here. And if you look also in the transport approach, we see which is the orange curves. So one is with regeneration, the other one is without regeneration. If you believe a bit if you push maybe a bit the uncertainties more than there are, it favors definitely a picture in which a very small fraction, I mean, the array of the 2S is already very, very small. It's 0.1, and maybe a small fraction of this could be regenerated epsilons. This being said, in the hydrodynamical calculation, which is in blue, you don't need the regeneration to grasp this double ratio. More precision on this double ratio is probably more than welcome. That's on CMS side. So now let's look a bit at the dependencies. So it shows to be very flat with PT, actually, both the 1S and the 2S within the statistics that we have. And again, the same models essentially reproduce the data with, again, maybe a small contribution from regeneration, in particular for the 2S. And here, I just flashed the differential yield, which are the things from which you derive the RA. And the intention of this slide was to pass over these yields to Florian. So I passed them over to myself. So from what we have seen, so essentially the PT dependence and the rapid and the centrality dependence, I think that everything looks like sequential suppression, very simple, with maybe the 1S not suppressed at all, because a large part of the 1S is coming from feed down, as we will see in the last part of the talks. This being said, the devil might be in the details, and I was passing over to a younger mind than mine to give the details, so I'll try to do it myself. Okay, so let's start with the rapidity differential measurement. So this was actually Florian's thesis in ALICE, the red point that extends the rapidity coverage of CMS at large rapidity, and it comes a bit surprising that for the 2S it goes down a bit, for the 3S it may go up a bit, but statistics is quite limited. This being said, there is a very large plateau over a large band of rapidity, and maybe this little drop, which is about 2 sigma significant and worth thinking of. In particular, because when you compare to models, there is at least one model, the hydrodynamical approach, that will more produce a raise as a function of rapidity than a drop. So it will more capture the 2S than the 1S. So in all this, in particular in the hydrodynamical framework, no details about the nuclear effects is taken into account. So, I mean, as usual, when we look at something which depends on rapidity, you better look have a careful look about the cold nuclear matter effects, in particular the NPDFs. That's what we do next. So this is the same plot. Again, the RA is a function of rapidity compared to some nuclear modification, cold nuclear matter effects predictions, essentially with the NPDFs. And so you see that the NPDFs, because of anti-shadowing, would more produce also a little raise in the forward direction rather than a little drop. And so it's difficult for it to describe both the CMS and ALICE data very carefully. But okay, this is RA. When you think about nuclear cold nuclear matter effects, you better look at the data. And so that's what we have at hand as RPA. In the backward and forward region on the left and on the right in ALICE, and in the central region in CMS in the middle. And so you see that indeed our PLED is lower than one a bit everywhere for the 1S. It's also ordered for the 2S and the 3S, as you can see in the middle plot. And definitely the NPDFs don't describe the backward suppression, which is on the left here. Okay, so trying to do a bit the same exercise as Roberta was doing, like putting backward times forward to try to guess what is the suppression from the RPA to the RAA. And so here you have the RPA in ATLAS on the left, and in ALICE on the right. So left is meter rapidity, and on the right it's forward rapidity. So that's why you have backward and forward on the right. And you see that indeed there are quite some suppression. At high PT there is not, actually. So which I find interesting in this plot is that clearly at high PT there is a large drop between PA and IA. Maybe it's more complicated in the at lower PT, but at large PT it's pretty clear. And the RA is maybe, let's say, 0.4. And this gives you a rough feeling that you could probably explain most of what's happening, at least at high PT, by just a mix of a small shadowing or something and the mix of the feed downs. And so the 1S is maybe resisting, but this we will try to assess more precisely in the future. Okay, back to lead. So this is a slightly different version of the plot I was showing at the beginning, with some JEPSAG going up with PT, which is one of the signs of regeneration, epsilon 1s and epsilon 2s. Just to make it clear, the even though these are plateaus that could look like the same thing, like a sequential melting, it's very, very different. I mean, two things that show that are really, really clearly different between Quarconia and Charmonia and Botomonia is when you look on the left at the V2, so JEPSI flows, epsilon don't flow. The statistical uncertainty is quite still large, but that was the new, I mean, recent result that shows that epsilons don't flow. And the PT behavior is very different. The JEPSI is regenerated. On the left side, you have a large regeneration component, which accumulates at low PT, while the epsilon 1s is just flat with as a function of PT, so unlikely to be affected by any regeneration. Okay, so that's quite some conclusion. So that, I mean, I think the basic picture of the sequential melting still holds, but there are new questions that arose from the more detailed measurements. One to which we should really try to answer quantitatively at some point is the direct epsilon 1s production affected? Again, the RA of the 1s is quite high, and it could be that just the feed down melts and the 1s survives. Also, we saw that there is an ordered suppression in PA collisions, which again is quite interesting. There is this hint of decreasing of the RA for the 2S and maybe increasing for the 3S that needs to be probably confirmed by data. And I think that's it. So one of the questions we want to address is with good accuracy is the feed down contributions, and this we show in the next talk. Some outlooks. So it's not the last word from CMS, actually. I mean, the analysis of the 2018 data set is still ongoing. So we have not released the very latest data on the epsilon. That's just because we are not enough people. So there will be a more precise measurement of the epsilon 2S suppression and maybe an observation of the epsilon 3S signals. If you pay me a drink tonight, maybe I can tell you or not. There are prospects, but this will be shown tomorrow, and I won't talk at all about polarization, but this was just done by Lucas, so it was covered in another talk. So I guess that's it for the AA and PA part of the epsilon talk, and I go back to the
okay. So thank you very much. Questions to Rafael?
so Rafael, can we go back to this rapidity dependence that you showed?
Like here?
Yeah, this one. So basically, you had arguments to explain that it goes counterintuitive to the hydrodynamical picture, but what are then the candidates' explanations?
So Florian might be able to answer the question because he thought a lot for his thesis about that. I did not. I mean, for me, the statistical uncertainty of the data is not yet strong enough so that I get crazy on this question. But
okay,
to make it down, I mean, well, that was my next slide. At least, I mean, NPDFs could have been, but no. I mean, it's the wrong region, so it goes down again.
I was not finished, but
I thought you wanted to give an element of answer.
Oh, it was just to that, in the sense, just to say that at 2.76, this kind of feature is even more pronounced. Sure. So let's say it might. Here I agree with Rafael. It's a bit at the level of the uncertainties, but there and it's difficult to understand.
True.
But I have myself question to this plot. If I looked on this upper description. Ah, okay. Sorry, Paul. No. Sorry, I thought you were done.
So the question is, because very naively, one could maybe think that what is populated to the epsilon 2s might be taken out from the epsilon 1s. Mm. And the question is, which one among the models that you have shown have precisely this kind of transition between 1s and 2s. It seems to me, for instance, that until very recently, model of Strickland, it was kind of diagonal in state. Okay, and also in this Boltzmann approach, there might be some suppression of state, but it's not because mm-hmm. you suppress that you regenerate something else. With Roland, I mean, we had this kind of transition, but we were too lazy to publish it in the end. But I think it would be interesting to look which model could have this kind of transition there.
And my question was to, it's a different PT range, by the way. If I looked what cover SMS, it's PT less than 30 GV and at least PT less than 15 GV. Could it have some kind of effect on this? Or
no,
did someone look at
the number of the perfect between 15 and 30, it must be less than 2% of the overall? So it's inclusive in PT. I mean, you cut at 15 or at 30, it doesn't change.
So it doesn't change. Okay, thank you. I see some hand from Ralph. Ralph, please go ahead with your question.
Thanks. I just wanted to comment on the question of whether this could be some interplay of relative reactions between psi prime, epsilon 1s and 2s. And I think the answer must be no, because it totally goes against DDL balance. You know, if you what these transitions should do is they should approach the relative thermal equilibrium limit. I'm not saying they reach it, they should approach it, but going closer to each other, they actually go away from that. So I'd be very surprised if a transport approach, which should be based on ultimately the correct thermal equilibrium limit, would give you an RAA that goes up for the 2s and down for the 1s.
Yeah, you want to comment?
Taken, I think, yeah. No.
Thank you.
We go into PP collisions, but not so much in terms of a review, but in terms of two things that we like and wanted to share with you. So it's not at all exhaustive on what you can say about epsilons in PP. So the first thing is a little report on something which is a work in progress. So you know Strong 2020. We're here partly thanks to Strong 2020. There is another package in there, which is called ONEXCOMB, which is GRA1, which its goal is essentially to put people from different collaboration together and to have them work to produce some reviews, some common work, combination of results and these kind of things. And so this little project is between CMS and LHCb, and in CMS it's Florian and myself, and in LHCb it's Benjamin and Julia, whom you know. And so the idea is to try to be quantitative on the feed down among Bottomania. I mean, there are already plenty of numbers in the air, and the idea is just to try to be a bit quantitative. And so as I just shown in the previous talk, essentially knowing precisely the amount of feed down is one of the important ingredients in understanding the sequential suppression, and in particular to answer this question that is the epsilon 1s melting at all at LHC or resisting to the coagulant plasma. And so there were some work, essentially early on at the LHC, like this talk by Ermin at the Quaconium Working Group in 2014. And our idea is just to revise this kind of approach and provide numbers, precise numbers as a function of PT, integrated in PT, as precise as we can on what is the feed-down fraction. So it's kind of a service, let's say, to the community that this work package is dedicated to. And so, for instance, here you have one publication by LHCb in which you have the KIBs to the three KIBs to the epsilon 1s. And you see that the fraction is quite large, in particular in high PT. And remember that it can play an important role for the 1s as a function of PT. And it goes down. And it's actually up to 30% just from only one state decaying into the 1s. So it's really the feed down fraction and the amount of epsilon 1s coming from something else than the 1s. Okay, so this is the overall chart of excited states. I guess you most of you know it, and I don't really need to elaborate on it. But there are quite so many states to be considered and carefully looked at. So one of the first things that we did in this overall starting project, that Florian did actually in this overall starting project, is to check that these ratios don't depend on rapidity. And indeed, this is the 3s over 2s, 2s over 1s, or the complementary 3s over 1s ratios as a function of rapidity on a large rapidity region. And it looks super flat. And so I guess the basic take-home message that we take from here is that you can really take the feed-down fractions anywhere in rapidity and derive an integrated feed-down fraction. So it's just a first check before to compute stuff. The other check is the question, could we use fractions at different square root of S to compute this? I mean, the idea is to compute the field that fraction at 5 TeV, so that is in the at the energy that we take AA collisions with. And the answer is that it's also quite close. I mean, you see the scale here, we are between 0.9 and 1.1. These are the same ratio at low PT from LHCb in the forward region. And we also have ratios, which is a bit more messy from CMS in the mid-rapidity region, but this time at high PT. So the idea is to integrate all this and to assess with some uncertainty the fact that we can use this ratio anywhere in rapidity, anywhere in square root of S to compute an overall feed-down fraction. And so that's where we are now. So this is a comprehensive plot of the feed-down contribution. So with to the 1s, so the 3s, the KB 3p in green, the 3s in yellow, the KB 2p in blue, the 2s in purple, and the KB 1p, which is the largest contributor, in red. So what we are left with is doing a proper extrapolation to lower PT for the KBs and to compute numbers for the community to use. And the main reason why we wanted to report on this work here is the last line. So if you have any suggestion on what we could do or what we're doing wrong or what we're doing right, that is very well welcome. And I guess it belongs to this workshop. That's it for this little subject. I do the other one and we take questions on the two at the end. Okay. Second part is I wanted to come back to the epsilon NS versus PP multiplicity. Well, it was already mentioned quite extensively by Zaida yesterday, so I will probably repeat a bit and going a little bit more in details. But it starts with a story. So the first loop that we had in CMS at PP collisions versus multiplicity was quite scary, actually. So this is the ratio of the states. 2s over 1s on the upper part and 3s over 1s on the lower part. And if you look at this purple point, it's really scary. I mean, you see that the ratio drops dramatically in a very short multiplicity range from, I mean, you lose essentially a third of your 2s's with respect to the 1s on this very little range. And if you look at the 3s, it's even worse. I mean, you lose, you have 3 at the beginning and only 1 at the end. With respect to the 1s. So this looks very scary at first. We were like saying, okay, maybe there is a little drop of coagulant plasma that is killing the epsilons, even in PP collisions, and you know this story. It's much more complicated than that. So first, I mean, there are two interpretations of this kind of drops. One is this the multiplicity that kills the states? or do the states come with different multiplicity? Because if the states come with different multiplicity, then they don't populate the bins in the same way, and you can create slopes very, very easily. I think that's the conclusion to which I will drive you to. One of the important other points that I want to make here, and I made it in a question yesterday also, is that this was the plot with the multiplicity measured as the forward energy in the Hadron forward calorimeters of CMS. And this was the multiplicity measured in the same rapidity than the epsilon, so the multiplicity essentially in the tracker. And you already see very clearly that the behavior is not the same, in particular for this low multiplicity points. So here it drops a lot, here it doesn't drop. And so clearly, I think it's obvious at the end, but we tend to forget it. When you look at very small multiplicity, the correlations between the probe and the multiplicity is to be taken into account seriously. Another illustration of this is the self-normalized ratio. Same paper, self-normalized ratio. So, you know, it's you divide the number of whatever you measure by the mean number of whatever you measured, and you do the same for your multiplicity variable. So it's one is the average, and two, it's two times the average, et cetera, et cetera. And so it's the same. On the left, it's with multiplicity measured in the forward region, and on the right, it's multiplicity measured in the mid-rapidity region. And you see that everything looks very linear when you put the multiplicity and the probe apart. While it's not the case at all, I mean, you have an enormous jump here about the epsilon 1s, for instance, at high multiplicity, if you do not do this, if you count the multiplicity in the same place as the thing that you look like. So one of the take-home messages is that definitely, I mean, the rapidity gap is important when you look at least at the lowest multiplicity region. And so this first paper, which was early on in 2014, triggered in CMS a very detailed analysis, which is done with 70 EV data. It came out as a preliminary result earlier, but as a publication only last year. And so this is it. So it's a high statistic analysis in PP collisions at 70 EV. Unfortunately, so I gave you the caution word about the forward energy, but unfortunately here we couldn't use the forward energy because we have pileup. So it's a calorimeter, so you cannot separate the pileup. So we had to use here the multiplicity as a number of tracks. So there is this potential bias everywhere in what follows, but we didn't have a choice. And there were two triggers, one minimum bias trigger, which is on the right here, but also a high PT trigger. So there is an enormous sample of epsilons with a PT threshold of 7 GV and a lower amount of epsilon. Well, in every end, we would dream of such a sample, but at lower PT. And so the blue and the green points are the same as what you were looking at before for PP collisions. And you immediately see that what looks like a dramatic drop, the purple point on the right, is indeed not a dramatic drop. It's more like there is a plateau. So it drops rapidly in the very lowest multiplicities, and then it plateaus. And you kind of have the same picture when you look at higher PT. So from now on, we will try to look at this observable in a very differential way to try to understand where is the multiplicity associated to the state. First, we look in fine PT bins. So this is the 2s on the right, on the left, and the 3s on the right. Same observable, the ratio of states as a function of the multiplicity. And you see that the effect is essentially seeable everywhere up to quite high PT. It goes down a bit when you go to higher PT. If you make a statistical test, you will infer that it's the largest in this 5-7 GV bin-like. But it is present everywhere. So the effect does not really depend on PT. That's one first observation. Another observation, so this time it's the mean PT of the states as a function of the multiplicity on the left on the high PT sample, on the right on the integrated sample, let's say. So that's why it's much higher on the left than on the right, obviously. And you see from there that there is definitely a correlation between the mass, the momentum, and the multiplicity. The higher multiplicity you get, the higher mass you get, and the higher momentum you get, actually. And actually, the higher states get higher momentum faster than the lower states. So it's also an interesting message. I mean, there is a positive correlation between the three. Another observation is to try to look at the multiplicity in a differential manner. So we split the sample in three. We count the multiplicity, which is in the direction of the epsilon with 2 pi over 3 angle. We count the multiplicity, which is backward. So this is essentially the red and the blue region. And we also count the multiplicity when it goes transverse to the direction of the epsilon 1s or 2s or 2s actually, or 3s. And we again plot the same, the ratio of the states for the 2s over 1s, 3s over 1s. And you see here that essentially it doesn't change anything. The behavior of this observable is the same wherever the multiplicity is. There may be a small difference at super low multiplicity with a higher yield in the backward region, which is probably, I mean, you have a epsilon with relatively high PT. This is limited to the, we can only do this analysis in the high PT sample. So you have an epsilon with high PT on one direction. Well, you have particles on the opposite direction, obviously. And probably a bit more for a 2s state than for a 1s state. But the key information here is that in particular, the effect is present when you look at the multiplicity in the transverse region, which really points to the fact that it must be really linked to the underlying event more than the epsilons themselves. Another piece of information that I put here is that on average, there is indeed three less tracks in the transfer region rather to compared with the forward and the backward on average. So it's really, there is really less activity in the transverse region to epsilon than in the backward or forward direction. Okay, so this brings a little bit more information in the game. I still have two information to give from this paper. One is we also looked at the isolation, namely, I mean, does it change something if I look at the epsilon which have comovers? I mean, particles that are in the same small cone with respect to it. So tracks in the same small cone with respect to it. And we split the sample in four categories, zero tracks in a small cone of delta R equal 0.5 around the epsilon. So isolated epsilons, let's say, one track, two track, and more than two tracks. And it doesn't change anything. The effect is the same everywhere. Just for a little information, one of the points that the very low multiplicity was blowing up, we did care here about removing the epsilon ns that goes to epsilon 1s plus 2 pi ns, so that two extra tracks in the cone. And we had to take care about this decay to make this plot. So that's interesting. It doesn't depend on if the epsilon is isolated or not. And the last observable was to look at sphericity. So this is there is four ranges in sphericity. Sphericity zero is a jetty event, so you have your epsilon and something behind, and essentially not much on the sides. And s equal one is more isotropic event. So this is the events that you think of like a bulk emission, possibly related to collectivity and this kind of stuff in the picture of a high multiplicity PP event. And indeed, so you see the effect everywhere, but not for the jetty events. So jetty events, they come with the epsilons with a jet, and the ratios are the same. The ratios don't depend on n-track when you look at jetty events. So again, pointing to the fact that it's really the underlying event multiplicity that is affected. And so it takes time to digest all these results. So I did it for you to some extent, but you can try to do it yourself. It's not easy. Well, my first message is that if you see an effect versus PP multiplicity, first, don't panic. Try to have a rapidity gap if you can, because probably a large part of the effect would not be here if we could make this very large analysis with a rapidity gap, but we couldn't. And try to have, if you have the data, I mean, and we should really push to have this kind of data at future LHC runs, a high statistic, super differential correlation study in PP. So it means low, having the proper trigger, having a high luminosity and all this kind of stuff. So I already said, so we have a lower dependence with a rapidity gap. The dependence is located at very low multiplicity. And this is a hint that indeed we are speaking of a few tracks extra, and it's not an effect that grows with multiplicity. It's an effect that is located at a bias of the multiplicity variable at low multiplicity. Well, and the bias expressed itself much more at very low multiplicity. The effect plateaus at large multiplicity. There is a positive correlation between mass, momentum, and multiplicity everywhere. So the more mass, the more momentum you have, the more multiplicity you have in the event. It does not depend on regional multiplicity. So again, it points to something which is underlying event driven. It does not depend on isolation, so it's not a story about co-moving things that kills the epsilons while they flow, and it's not, and there is no effect for JT events. I mean, the multiplicity is not where the multiplicity not, is not driven by the underlying event, but more by the JT-ness of the event. So my conclusion is well, I think this effect that we saw, I think it just comes from the fact that the epsilon NS comes with different multiplicity. They just show up with different multiplicity. So if you make super fine bins in multiplicity, then you change the ratio by construction. And the other thing is that I think we should, when we look at probe multiplicity analysis in PP collisions, we should really try to have this rapidity gap. So this result is not so much advertised in the heavy ion community. So that's why I wanted to go thoroughly through it with you guys. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Remember, we had to come before.
Some questions? Okay, I see some hand here. Anton, please go ahead.
Thank you, Rafael, for the very nice talk. I have two, actually, if I may. If you would consider to analyze or give, I'm not sure, I don't remember now your paper, which I looked up, but some time ago when it appeared, whether you give not only ratios of 2S to 1S, but 1S normalized to inclusive, whether this would be possible for you. This is something that is, of course, also, I think, very interesting for the production mechanisms, and 2S versus normalized to inclusive. And my second question is whether you did anything or gave a thought on the fact that 2S and 1S have different signal to background ratios, and that may lead to some washing in the direction, in the way you define the direction to which you, when you look in the regions, in the three regions.
Okay, so first question, by inclusive, you mean the self-normalized ratio, or do I mean
something? Yes, yes.
Yeah, so I don't think we have them in that paper, but in the previous one we had them. So so in the previous paper that was the picture, but I'm not no, I don't think it was redone in the in
as far in, as I recall not
and
in
the reason and the reason is that we it's very triggered, so we don't know the inclusive, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the second question was the background.
Yes.
Yes, the background is different, but how do you know where it comes from with respect to epsilon? I'm not sure I understood your question, actually.
Well, so, you do a statistical average, essentially, and the direction of the epsilon is, of course, influenced by the presence of the background, right? The background wobbles this direction, in a sense, right?
It's sideband subtracted.
So it's sideband subtracted.
Yeah.
So in principle, that is at least in first order taking care of it.
In principle, you get rid of the background and it raises the uncertainties. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question from Matt. Matt, please ask your question.
Hi, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Great. So I have a question about this isolation stuff, which is really interesting. So if I understand correctly, you get a epsilon or like a dimuon and then count how much is around it in the in a cone, right?
Yeah.
And make these ratios. So I would think that, you know, by selecting epsilons that survived, you are, you know, fundamentally not sensitive to epsilons that have been broken up.
Exactly.
So I don't know how you can say much about breakup if you are just not able to measure that.
Yeah. Yeah, you quote one of the main limitations of the overall study. And you still have all of them here and it does not depend. I mean, the ratio does not depend. So if it were depending, then the interpretation would be complicated because of what you said. But here it doesn't change anything if you look at the number of tracks that are close to the states. I'm not sure if I'm clear.
No, I think you. I think this takes some digestion that I haven't been through yet. This is.
But the effect that you mentioned would move some of the epsilons from one of the set to the other set, And so the four sets should not look alike. If I mean, we don't miss any epsilons here. They're all there. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, not the ones that break up, but they don't break up depending on the cone because.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, but it's a tricky analysis. I definitely agree.
Yeah, I think it's a tricky interpretation.
Yeah. Well, the analysis was not easy either, but it's done, so it's behind us.
We have a question from our audience. Paul, please go ahead.
Yes, all right. We are given a lot of food here, so digestion is a bit difficult. So maybe you can help me a little bit by telling what are clearly the signals. They go against this very naive interpretation that there is something, not maybe a QGP droplet, but something denser, a couple of fields, okay? And please show me what rules out this picture.
Yeah, I think it depends on who you talk to, but since you're talking to me.
Yes, I am.
For me, it's the plateau here. Okay. If there was really an effect depending on the multiplicity, then it should grow with the multiplicity. Right. And it does not.
Saturation.
You only see it in the very lowest multiplicity in which adding one or two tracks really changes things. While at higher multiplicity doesn't. I mean, you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
but this was not enough to convince some of my colleagues. So.
Rafael, I wonder whether you have planned to connect the two parts of your talks, that on the, yes, on the feed down with that on the dependence of the multiplicity, if you can see any connection between the two.
Measuring the feed down as a function of multiplicity? That,
or there can be
that
some
could be effect. Interesting, yeah. But I guess we lack a lot of measurements. But we could think about it all together.
Okay, I see no other questions. So thanks a lot, Rafael.
Thank you, guys.